Hope all of you are able to see my screen. So as you can see here, we will be starting with an introduction to the next container type, which is called a set. All right, so sets in Python, you can use them for storing immutable types, right? And the second point is sets cannot have mutable items. Unlike, say, for example, within a tuple, you can have a list which is mutable. Within a set, you cannot have a mutable item, right? So these are the key points that I've just listed here. And the most important aspect of a set is it ignores duplicates. Okay, so even if you have duplicates within the set, and when you print the set, the duplicates are ignored. And unlike lists and tuples, right, there is no ordering or positioning or indexing for sets, right? And yes, sets are mutable, right? So we will or there are methods available wherein you can add, remove items to the set, right? And just like with lists and tuples, right, they are very much fast in searching. So fast membership testing is supported with sets. So these are the important points that you guys need to remember with respect to sets. Now let us see an example of how you can create a set and how to represent a particular set with items, etc. Right, so let me show that through REPL this time. So here in my REPL prompt, say, for example, how do you represent a set? Any ideas, guys? Already, though, I think some of you have done some experiments using sets. So those who have done your lab exercise using sets, can you say how do you represent a set? Or how to create a set?
Curly braces.
Using curly braces. But again, guys, tell me, like, using curly braces only, you create a dictionary also, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So first of all, let us understand that. So if you say type of this, right? So what is this type? Is it a set or is it a dictionary?
Dictionary,
set, set.
Yeah, somebody said set, somebody said dictionary, right? So let us see the type. It says it is a dictionary, right? But again, as you correctly said earlier, you make use of curly braces only to represent a set also, right? So if you say this explicitly, say if I say this as a set, right? Now this is a set, this is an empty set, all right? But how do we have items within a particular set, right? You can say within a curly brace, a 1, 2, right? Now this is a set. All right, so this is how you represent a set, right? And the items within a set all contain immutable types. So if you want to store immutable types, right, you can make use of a set, right? And you cannot have mutable items within a set. Say set, basically, guys, it makes use of a hashing kind of technique behind the scenes, right? So you need not worry much about the hashing algorithm that is used behind the scenes of how things get work, or how things work behind the scenes with respect to hashing on the set aspect, for now at least. All right, so what was I telling now? So you cannot have mutable items, this particular point, right? So you cannot have mutable items. So for example, if I have a set and if I have a list, right, with one item, right, inside this, right, I cannot do this. It says, as you can see here, it's a type error. It says unhashable type list, right? So you cannot have mutable items. And the next point is it ignores duplicates, guys. So even if you have a set with duplicates, say 1, 1, 2, 3, right? What do you think the answer will be? It ignores the duplicates. So it will just give you the unique values 1, 2, and 3, right? And the next thing is, say for example, I represent this guy inside a container, and if I print the container, it is 1, 2, 3, right? Unlike lists and tuples, right, they does not have any specific order, right? And also, the items cannot be indexed. You cannot say something like this A of 0 and expect that you get the item 1, right? That object is not subscriptable, right? So item indexing is not possible in sets, right? If time permits, we'll talk about the methods that are available in sets as well when we talk about the methods available in lists and tuples later in its dedicated unit, right? See, sets are very much useful if you already have done high school mathematics. They are very much useful in doing your union, intersection, difference, all those operations. Sets are very, very useful. All right. Second thing, sets are mutable, right? So sets are mutable. That means there are methods available wherein you can add items to a set, remove items from a set. For example, I have A is 1, 2, 3. And I can say something like A dot add. I think there's a method called as add, should be there. I am not quite sure. Let me see. And if I say A, you can see 20 is added, right? Similarly, there is something called as remove, and there is also something called as discard. There's a small difference, we'll talk about that later. So discard 20. So if the item is available in that particular set, it will be removed, right? Now if I say A again, it is 1 2 3, 20 is removed, right? So sets are mutable, right? And as with lists and tuples, right, the searching is very, very fast. Say for example, if I say the string 1 in A, right, it is false, right? Let me search for 3, which is available, right? It says true. All right, so this is a very high level brief introduction to sets, guys. Understood? Any doubts on this? Next is strings. Strings are also immutable. Sorry, strings are also containers, although we have not put that as an explicit point here. Now I have put it, right? So strings are also containers because they contain a list of or a sequence of characters, and strings are immutable, right? And strings can be indexed. They are zero-based indexing, right? And can you mutate strings? As I said, it is immutable, right? If you say, for example, if I say A is equal to, say, hello, and if I say A of, say, 0, it can be indexed, I get H, right? And if I say explicitly A of 0 is equal to, now say, B, right? Can this be done, guys?
No.
Yes.
This cannot be done. String is immutable. String object does not support item assignment. All right. And one more thing, say whatever container you have, right? So here in this case, A is a container which contains a string, right? For any particular container, if you want to check the number of items, right, you can make use of the global function, which is called as len, right? So you can say len and pass in the container name, in this case A, right? A is 5. If I now say have A, which is a list, say 1, 2, 3, say 45.6, which is a float, and if I have a string which is also immutable, say SSS, right? And if I say length of A, it is 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, right? So you can make use of the length built-in global function to find the number of items within any particular container that you want to probably make use of. So far, so good, guys. Any questions?
Sir?
Yes?
Sir, can you repeat the point of no item indexing?
No item indexing. Say, for example, I have a set here. This is my set, all right? So in this particular set, if I want to get my first item, right? So typically I would make use of a notation something like this, right? So subscript operator, and I will do the first item. So if I want to get the first item of this particular set, right? So this is not supported in set. That is called as no item indexing.
Oh, okay, sir.
This
yes, sir.
Got set it,
sir.
Object is not subscriptable.
Yes, sir.
All right. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Okay, so let us move on, guys. Fine. So we were talking about operators in the previous class, right? So, okay. So before we continue, guys, there is one more thing that we missed out in the previous talk or session, right? Which is this particular operator. This is also bitwise operator that you can make use of. And what is this operator, bitwise operator, guys? Any guess?
Not.
Bitwise not, right? So bitwise not, it will give you the inverse of the bits, all the bits. All right, so let us see an example maybe. So let us say x equal to, say, 4, all right? And say print x, right? So this is going to print 4, right? And also let me print, or let me just print the not of x. What do you think will be the answer, guys? Just work out using your paper and pencil and tell me the answer. What will be the answer in decimal? What is not of x in decimals?
0.25.
Is it 0.25? Before you see the answer, I want you guys to find out. Please do not make use of any online compiler or anything like that and see the answer and tell the answer now. Please try to find out using a paper and pencil and tell me the answer. So how do you find the bitwise not?
Is it 0, 1, 1?
See, what is the bitwise representation of 4?
0, 1, 0, 0.
Okay, it's 0, 1, 0, 0, 100, correct? So
yes, zero, sir.
0, 1, 0, 0, if you do a bitwise not, right?
1, 0, 1, 1.
1011.
Okay, so it is 1011. All right.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now, guys, this is actually by default it is plus 4. Right. So, see, when you actually do a not of x, which is 1011 here in this particular case, right, it is essentially the not of x for 00100, because see, the first zero represents your sign bit, right? Your sign bit is zero if it is a positive number. All right, in this particular case, 00100, the first zero is a sign bit. Zero means positive, right? So when you do inverse of that, it is going to be essentially 11011, correct? Because negative representation is using a 1. All right. So if your binary representation as per your calculation, right, is 11011, right, then what is the answer if it is 11011?
Minus 11.
Is it? See, what you can expect is you can expect a decimal number in negative, right? Because it is a negative number. So 1011 is what? Can you guys able to trace? See, what you said is correct. 100100, it is, the inverse is 1011, right? But just that is going to be represented in a negative manner, right? So when you have the negative representation of 11011, right? So it is essentially your 2's complement, right? So when you do the 2's complement, right, you can expect this to be -5. All right. So if this logic works out correctly for you guys with this particular simple number, now if I say if it is 100, what is the answer? So you can do a mapping, right? So if it is 4, you get -4. If it is 100, it is going to be
-101,
right? And if it is say -100, what is your guess?
101.
99.
Is it 101 or 99? You get 99, right? So these operators, all these bitwise operators are extensively used in encryption algorithms, decryption algorithms, etc., right? And to be very frank, all these years of my coding experience, I have never touched or used bitwise operators for any of my problem solving, right? Anyways, it might be useful for any particular specific cases that you might encounter in future. All right, so that,
sir, can you repeat the bitwise not?
Bitwise not is just the 2's complement. 2's complement of that particular number, which actually gives you the inverse of that number.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, pause here. And guys, to be very honest, I am very, very poor in mathematics. Excuse me for that. Guys, where did we leave? Yeah, so, okay, so let us have a revisit. So this is what? Bitwise?
And
bitwise, this is OR, and this is bitwise XOR. Right, and bits get flipped when you XOR with 15, right? So you can have this as a kind of cheat sheet and refer to it whenever it is required, right? So these things will be hardly required in your day-to-day problem solving activities, right? But still it is supported, so it is better to have this as a kind of reference. All right, and this is bitwise not. And guys, what is this? This we have already explored.
Left shift
and right shift. All right, so apart from these arithmetic bitwise operators, okay, we also have this comparison operators. We have we had a small look at this earlier, right? So I hope all of you are comfortable with these comparison operators, or do you want to see any kind of example with any of these operators? Equal to, not equal to, greater than, less than, less than or equal to, greater than or equal to, and logical operators. So logical operator, guys, this is AND, OR, and NOT, right? So logical AND, logical OR, logical NOT. Any questions or doubts or examples you want to see through REPL or otherwise for any of these operators?
Sir, can you explain that double greater than sign, like?
Yeah, double greater than is equality testing. You test for or you compare two values are equal or not.
Not the equal to one, sir. Like double.
Sir, in the bitwise operator.
Yeah.
The bitwise operator, you don't have any doubles. Double equal to is not here.
Double greater than.
No, sir, he's telling right shift.
This one.
That one, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
This is the right shift operator. So, say for example, in the REPL, if I say A is equal to say 10, right? And say B is equal to say 1, right? And if I say A greater than B, right? So this means that all the bits or the bits in A will be right shifted by 1. Okay, so if A greater than right shift by B, A is now 5. You can trace this out with the bit representation. You can put the bit representation of this and 1, and you can see the resultant will be 5.
Like, what are we actually doing? Like,
okay, so you want to have a much more better understanding. So if I have this, say A, right, or say 10 as in the REPL, right, and if I say print, let us have the bitwise representation of this. So if I say B, all right, now if I do this, why is this not, why B is not defined? Did we not represent the bitwise operator this way, guys, earlier?
OB.
Huh?
It should be OR 0 before B.
See, I don't want any zero. Say, even if you want a zero, there is some silly mistake happening here. Okay, let me first print A. I get 10, but
sir,
I want
to use F, sir.
No, I want the bitwise representation of 10. So I can make use of the placeholder, no? Or a format specifier. And can I not say, give me the bitwise representation using B this way?
Sir, but do we have to use F inside the print first?
Where we need F, no, sir.
For format specifier, F strings are required?
Not sure, sir.
Okay, let us test it out. I think it is not required. Anyways.
Sir, B is not specified, sir.
No, no, B is not specified, correct. But I'm using this as a format specifier using colon so that this B should give me a binary representation of A. That is what I'm trying to do. Am I not in the correct location? I think, yeah. Yeah. I am not in the correct location. This file is somewhere else. So let me see where it is. So it is in unit 2. And I guess it is in 01 intro. All right, I have test here. Okay, so let me test it out now. Yeah, I get 1010, and now let me go back to the previous representation, and this should work, I guess. Okay, let me remove this. Okay, it still says B is not defined, so F string is required. Okay, so you put using F and give me a representation of A in binary. Okay, 1010. Now coming to our right shift operation, let me do a right shift by 1. So B equal to 1, right? Now let me also print the binary version of B. Right? And okay, let me have some spacing. Say, let me have totally 8 bits. Okay? And let me pad it with zeros. All right, 1010 0001. All right, now you do a right shift. Right now you can see the output and do the right shift and tell me the answer. Right shift 1010 by 1 bit. Last time we saw a similar example, right shift by 1. So what will happen?
Four zeros, 101.
Right? One. So this is getting shifted to the right. So 101. Understood, guys? So let us print that as well. So let me say this is C. And let me print C. To get 101. If you have some, if you want some padding, you can have that as well. Right? So is it understandable now?
Yes, sir. So you are shifting like the A, the bit rate, bits of A to right side, like just one place.
Yeah, just by 1 bit to the right hand side.
Okay, sir.
Now guess what, if it is going to be 2. Shift by 2 bits. So it is going to be
0010.
See, shift by 2 bits. So 101 is here, so it is going to be 10.
6010.
Yes, yeah. Sir.
So it is going to be 10.
Okay, sir.
Got the concept? The similar is the manner with left shift. Left shift, you go to the left hand side, shift it by left, and adjust the bits accordingly and print the output. All right, guys?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Where were we? We were here. Okay, so this is left shift. This is right shift. All right, so these are the comparison operators and these are the logical operators, logical AND, logical OR, logical NOT. Can you just tell me what is the difference between logical AND and logical OR very quick?
For logical AND, both of the conditions should be true for the whole expression to be true. Okay. For logical OR, either one has to be true for it to be true, and both of them have to be false for the expression to be false.
Correct. Where did my editor go away? Just 1 second, guys. Yeah, it's coming back. This is release notes. Okay. And yes, we also had a talk about identity and membership. Can you tell me what is identity?
It's like an address in the memory, sir.
It is like an address in the memory. Okay. So what is the difference between identity is and equal to, double equal to? Somebody raised this question already earlier. Now can you tell me?
Sir, is and is not will check change in objects, sir. Like, but equal to will be change in values.
Yeah, so correct. So you make use of double equal to look for change in values, whereas is to check for the object identity. All right, any doubts on this? Okay, what is membership in and not in, guys?
It checks whether the object is in a list or a string.
which checks whether an item is available inside a container.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so that is membership, right? And our next topic is precedence of operators. So operator precedence, this is the operator precedence by default from highest to lowest, right? But it is always recommended or considered to be a good practice to make use of parentheses for explicit precedence of operators, right? So just a simple example, I think this is elementary school idea, right? So this particular idea is applicable here in this programming language Python as well. Say for example, if I do a 10 slash 10, say plus 2, right? Now what is the answer? I have not used any explicit parenthesis. If you want to be explicit, you can change the order of operation, right? So in this particular case, what is the answer?
102.
Right, it is 102, right? Now if I say this is like this way, what is the answer?
120.
All right, so got it. So that is the idea, right? So precedence of operators by default from highest to lowest bindings or highest to lowest precedence, right? It works in this particular manner, right? So by the way, can you tell me what is this operator?
Power.
What is plus k minus k?
Positive, negative.
Increment or
decrement. Unary operators.
Yeah, they are unary operators. And what is this?
Inverse.
It is bitwise not, right? And all these operators fall on the same level, right? Addition, multiplication, division. What is this?
Integer division.
And what is this?
Modulus.
After that, you have got addition and subtraction at the same level. After which you have, what is this?
Left shift, right shift.
Bitwise left shift and right shift. This is bitwise and, bitwise or, bitwise. Is this bitwise or XOR?
XOR.
So this is bitwise XOR and this is bitwise OR, right? And what is this operator called as? In and not in?
Membership
operator. And is and not is? No, is not?
Identity.
Identity operators. And what are these operators called as?
Comparison
operators, right? And then what are these operators called as?
Logical.
Not and or, logical operators, right? So this is the default operator precedence, order of operator precedence in Python, how things will be executed in an expression. If you want to change the order of execution in an expression, you can do it by explicitly using a parenthesis or a set of parentheses. Clear, guys?
Sir?
Yes?
Sir, you told multiplication, division, and integer division fall under the same level, no, sir?
Correct.
Say if I give 10 into 10 divided by 12, then what will be the output? Can you show it?
10 okay.
That's 12.
Divided by 12. Okay, there is no parenthesis. So, what do you think will happen?
Under
divided by 12. So it is going to be some kind of floating point number, right?
If both are of same order, then why is it taking 10 into 10 first, sir? Why can't it take 10 slash 12 first and then multiply it by 10?
No, it goes, expression gets evaluated from left to right by default.
Okay.
Sir. Yeah. Now coming back to this particular slide here, these are the repetitions, comparison, logical, identity, right? Okay, now some guesswork or guess the output of the below, right? What is the answer for this? Bool of zero, what do you think will be the answer? Let us not execute, you tell me the answer.
False.
Yeah. You also from your side, do not execute, see the answer and tell me. right? Do it manually. What is the answer for bool of 10?
True.
Okay. What is the answer for bool of minus 34?
True.
Somebody said false. I heard a sound coming false. It is not false. Okay, it is true. Even for negative numbers, it is true. What do you think bool of an empty list?
False.
Correct. Bool of a empty, what is this notation?
Dictionary.
Yeah, what is bool of an empty dictionary?
False.
Correct. What is this notation?
Tuple.
What is bool of an empty tuple?
False again.
Correct. What is this?
Empty set.
Yeah. So what is bool of an empty set? If you do it this way?
False.
What is bool of a list with one item?
True.
What is bool of a tuple with one item?
True.
What is bool of a dictionary with set with one item?
True.
What is bool of a dictionary with a key and a value? Yeah, so whether one value or multiple values in any particular container, if you have items, right, the expression is true. All right, what is bool of none, guys?
False.
What is bool of this one, line number 41?
True. False.
What is line number 42?
True.
Why do you think so?
It has a character.
Because it's white space.
Correct.
White space is there.
Absolutely. Line number 43.
True.
Can I do something like this? Or this is, what is the output here? If I just say true equal to 10.
Sir, I don't think it will show an error, sir. I think it will show an error.
It's a keyword. We can't assign values
to you can't assign values to a keyword.
You can't assign values to a keyword. True. Right? So, let us check this out. As you said, it's a keyword. If I assign a value, right, it shows me an error. Absolutely right. How about this? Similarly, you cannot do this. Can you do this? Line number 46.
No, sir.
No.
Yeah. Tell me if capital A is greater than small a.
False.
Yeah, why do you think so?
ASCII values of.
Sir, I think it will be an error because it can't compare directly like that.
It can. Generally, in strings in Python, right? Under the hood, ASCII values are compared, and if you see the ASCII value of capital letters are lower than the
small letter.
Yeah.
So we can directly compare strings and find out which is which has a lower ASCII value.
Yeah. You can compare strings. Say, for example, is hello less than say world. In this case, what is the answer?
Yes, it should be true.
How do you say that? It compares the individual characters. H is less than W, it's true, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so that's it. True.
Oh. Okay, sir.
Yeah. And is this okay? Is X less than Y? Line number 48.
Yes.
Yeah, X is less than Y, right? Yeah. And is hello equal to hello? H is in lowercase here, H is in uppercase.
It will be false.
It is false, right? Is 10 comma 20 equal to 10 comma 20?
Yes.
True, sir.
True.
Okay.
True.
Now if I have A is equal to 10 comma 20 and B equal to 10 comma 20, and if I do a check with S, is A is B?
Yes, sir.
True, sir.
False.
Yeah, so this will be false. Why this will be false?
Identity can be same only for immutable types.
Correct. Both are different objects. So S is object is for object identification. All right. And this is the equality testing. Although both are lists here, right? Both the values are the same here. Using equality, you check for the values. Using S, you check for the object. Sorry, guys. What do you think is the answer for line number 54, 10 and 20? Now this is a little trickier. Do not execute. Guess what?
True.
Okay. Now I'm see. Fine. Both are true, right? 10 and 20, right? But it actually prints out the second value, the truth value, which is the second item. Okay. So if I do this, let me just copy and paste. It's not getting copied. It says 20. Okay, guys, it gives you the truth value, right? Which is 20 here, which is essentially the second value will be printed. Okay, now if you see this, what will be the answer for line number 55? Do not do it. Now make a guess. Empty and empty. That is false, and false is what?
False.
False and false is false. But
false.
Yeah, what value will you get? Now that you have seen 10 and 20 gives you the value of 20, what value do you think will you get for this?
Second.
Yeah. And this. So it should give you the flower bracket, right? So it is giving you the square bracket. So what is happening? See, guys, false and false is false, right? So yeah, so the first item will be given to you. Say you can do this explicitly, false and false, right? So this first item is going to be returned. The value of the first item, the value of the first item here is false. The value of the first item here is the empty list, that is going to be returned, right? Now, if this condition satisfies to be true, the value of the second item is going to be returned. Just remember this in your mind. All right, guys? Are things clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, coming to line number 56. Now tell me, this is false and this is true. False and true is what?
First element will be executed.
False.
Yeah, first element is going to be executed. Right? So that is right. Okay. Now, what is line number 57? One or two?
One.
Two, sir.
No, whether you will get the answer is one or two?
One.
One. Yeah, you will get the first item. Right? Line number 57. That we have seen now, 58. One or two?
So one doubt, sir.
One.
Yeah. One. Yeah, somebody had a doubt.
Yes, sir. In 10 and 20, we got 20.
Yeah.
But in one or two, like, okay.
Yeah, one or two, you get the first element. 10 okay. And 20, both are true, you get the second element. Anyway, whether see the element is just the second element here, the in or the element is the first element being written. But if you have an element as the return value, that essentially means it is true, right? That is how the logical operators work. They give you a return value back.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. All right. Line number 58, we have seen. Line number 59. Empty list, which is false or true?
False.
Yes, tense, sir.
False or true is false or true?
True.
True, right? So false.
Square bracket will be printed.
Yeah. You get 20. 0 or 200?
200.
Is it? What do you guess? Or what do you say?
200.
It is 200. Right? Because see, false, right? False or true?
True.
Yeah, true. So you get 200. So this time it is the second element. Okay? Not 100. Don't do it. Tell me.
False.
Why false? Because 100 is true, so not true is
false.
False. False. Line number 62.
True.
True.
True. Yeah.
Okay, so this helps you understanding the logical operators, right, and the outputs accordingly. All right, so any doubts on this, guys?
Sir?
Yes?
Sir, flower bracket 1 or 2, sir?
Flower bracket 1 or flower bracket 2?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so it is like true or true? Flower bracket 1 is
true, sir.
Flower bracket 1 is true, flower bracket 2 is also true. So true or true will give you true. So the value of true is 1, yeah. 1 is going to be printed.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah?